I want to buy Medicinal Purposes of the Pale. Indeed, she mumbles, staring at the book for a moment. Something about that book does seem to have spoken to you. Well, I hope it contains what you're looking for. Me too. Reading books. Some of you probably think this is a waste of money, but... A small green book giving off a peculiar foreboding impression, although it's hard to figure out why. It describes the various ways of healing debilitating ailments through the use of pale, some of which sound implausible at best. The cover of this heavy tome features a number of esoteric symbols. Opening the book. Breakthrough imminent. Oh, and that. See, this passes time. Look, it's already like after 5:30 now. Flipping through the book, you find a number of sections on the general benefits of the pale. A large pharmacopoeia makes up nearly half of the book. I can skip to here. Oh, it's just telling me I'm close to it. Breakthrough imminent. Thanks for letting me know. What's a pharmacopoeia? You come across the following explanation. While modern pharmacopoeia are continually updated by so-called experts based on the results of clinical trials, readers will find assembled here the timeless wisdom relied upon by generations of traditional solite medicine practitioners, mystics, say that for five times fast, and Ilmarian folk doctors. Encyclopedia says it's all quackery, in other words. Inland Empire says, finally, something to calm the angry spirits that have been plaguing you. Huh. Well, I hope there's more to it than just quackery. It seems to contain descriptions on the medicinal properties of various ingredients that may be gathered from the pale, as well as instructions for producing a variety of herbal remedies. Restoring lost memories, soothe the relentless torment of my existence. Apocalyptic hangover. Is there anything in there about restoring lost memories? There are a number of solite tonics that promise to improve your short-term memory, but nothing that speaks to your condition. Anything about curing an apocalyptic hangover? There's nothing in here that speaks to hangovers directly. However, while browsing through the various descriptions, you become convinced that you could assemble something from the ingredients listed here. Want to give it a shot? Rubbing my hands together. All right, book, let's see what you've got. First, you need to choose a base ingredient. I'm guessing. Are these educated guesses, or am I just throwing something out there? Ginger root? Next, you'll need to combine the base ingredient with an appropriate vehicle. A dram of whiskey. Tea made from birch bark. I boil it with a tea made from birch bark. I like the aloe vera idea too, though, but tea seems more appetizing than a paste. Lastly, is there anything else you'd like to add? Ooh. A few pomegranate seeds, definitely. I love pomegranate. The ginger root will help with the nausea, and the birch bark tea will help you flush out the toxins. The pomegranate seeds are a natural aphrodisiac. That's a nice bonus. Are they really? I didn't know that. I feel like looking that up just to see if that's true in real life. Healed morale. The very thought of this tea causes your muscles to relax and your mind to clear. You're more present and in control than you were a moment ago. I didn't even make anything or drink anything. Okay, let's savor the feeling a moment longer, why not? A tingle rushes down your spine and you feel your toes uncurl. If only it could always be like this. Really, just thinking about it. I want to try to concoct one of those hangover cures again. How about a sprig of fresh mint? No whiskey. Mash into a paste with some aloe vera extract. And some wild ginseng root. The ginger root will help with the nausea, and the birch bark tea will help you flush out the toxins. The ginseng should give you more energy as a nice bonus. You imagine yourself with a mug of this tea in a chair by the window. It's a beautiful image, but will it ever come true for you? Common meadow rue. How about a dram of whiskey? And a spoonful of sugar. You've created a delicious tincture of whiskey and ginger. According to the pharmacopoeia, it should increase your energy and focus, though in your experience, it's only done the opposite. Would you like to try again? Okay, how about mixing things up? Ginger, aloe vera, and ginseng. You've created a delicious mixture of whiskey and ginger. According to the pharmacopoeia, it should increase your energy and focus, but in your experience, it's only done the opposite. Wait, did I? Whiskey and ginger. Wait a second. Ginger. Aloe vera. No. The tea. And ginseng. It says whiskey and ginger. I did not choose a whiskey. Why is it doing that? Okay. No, this stuff is a bunch of hooey anyway. You close the book and find yourself staring at the familiar cover once more. I think I just want some general health advice. Have you taken any walks through the pail recently? I don't even know what this pail thing is. How could I have walked through it? The book is frustratingly vague on this topic, but it seems that if you walked through the pail, you would know it. Maybe? And on your walks, did you stop to meditate on the nature of your being? No, I don't. You need to do that. It's important for opening up your agiogenous zones. What are agiogenous zones? They're a series of psychic nodes located throughout your body. Unfortunately, the stresses of modern life often cause us to close off our agiogenous zones, which can result in all manner of physical and psychic ailments. Regular meditation in the pail, however, can help to open up those zones, permitting the free flow of psychic energy throughout the body. Okay, then I do very much so. I meditate all the time. Good. And when you meditate, are you in the nude? Oh yeah, buck naked. Excellent. You're doing everything as you should. Regular pail meditation has been shown to help keep your body lithe and strong, your mind alert and expansive. A note of caution, however, be sure to limit your exposure to the pail to no more than an hour per day and no more than 3 hours total per week. So once I reach the pail through this meditation? Or I have to travel to the pail to get there? Thought complete for rigorous self-critique. Here it is. Hard facts of the man you are. You once jerked off in the locker room and were caught. You held a young woman by the arm and kept her in your apartment for 20 minutes against her will. That's right. These are not flights of fancy. Well, that's not good. These are real deeds, Harry, emerging from the darkness of your past. You tried shooting a fleeing suspect in the foot, but hit him in the pelvis, crippling him for life. And above all, you let life defeat you. All the gifts your parents gave you, all the love and patience of your friends, you drowned in a neurotoxin. You let misery win, and it will keep on winning till you die or overcome it. Okay. Okay, good. Red check failures, heal. So still failing, but healing. Learning cap for pain threshold raised to 6. Oh, okay. Bonuses from the thought. Okay, so if I get failures on these, it heals morale and health. I mean, I have plenty of drugs for that. And I don't know how high I need to make the pain threshold, so can I forget this one? Thought will be lost forever. Sure. Because I want this one. Arno van Eyck. I have 50 minutes. I'll go read another book. There's no other books there. Oh, that book, the Dick Mullen book's expensive. This one. Biographies of famous people. Okay, this is my last one for now, because it's going to put me down to almost 20 real. The Greatest Innossence. A true cultural touchstone, she nods. Enjoy the read. And maybe when I'm done reading this book, that thought Van Eyck thought will be complete. Because time passes when you read these books. The Greatest Innossence. Even though it has two S's here, but only one in the image. This dusty tome brings knowledge on the history of innocences. Oh, right. Like, what's her name? The stained glass image in the church. It is written by one Gio Paolo Salomeo Lopez de Fuego, a mesque fascist who tries to reach a conclusion on which of the innocences is the coolest in the world. The coolest, huh? This, yeah, I'm not reading all that again. The book is large and heavy. Crack open this immense tome. Browsing through the various chapters, look at that, it's like 9:03 p.m. Browsing through the various chapters, you try your best to understand the ceaseless overflow, the sprawl of names, dates, places, events, historical. Most of it ends up as a twisted mass of facts inside your brain. And Duran says, you can do it. It'll be worth it. There's something here. Your educational survey is done. Did you catch any of that? No? Oh, well, it's pop quiz time. Let's see what you've learned. This might take a few minutes. You ready? I didn't read anything. Sure, why not? So it's not me taking the test. Harry's taking the test. But yet I have to choose. That's the spirit. Here we go. Question number one. Who was the first innocent? Encyclopedia says, oh yeah, this is what I was made for. Right, this is the one in the church. She was not the first one, if I remember right. But she was probably the greatest. Well, Encyclopedia can help me. I really didn't realize I was over anything from what I just read. Okay. That's so, Encyclopedia? Alright, go on. Give me all the hints you got. Are you kidding me? He's telling me about a pop quiz, not about the answer to the question. A pop quiz is a short examination designed to test your knowledge without any prior warning or announcement. Such exams allow the teacher to assess how thoroughly the students have retained the material at hand. Voila! Now blast at first innocence. Half-Light says, thanks for nothing. Exactly. I am Half-Light right now. Pain Threshold says, Dolores Day. Dolores. I didn't think she was the first one. Should I listen to Pain Threshold? Can Pain Threshold be wrong? I think it's... Isn't this a group of people? Pain Threshold. Dolores Day? Pain Threshold, I don't know if you're right. Incorrect. Thanks a lot, Pain Threshold. Dolores Day was the innocence of humanism, internationalism, and the welfare state. She codified parliamentary democracy and created modern institutions. Among these, the moral intern. She was beautiful. Sorry, she was powerful and beautiful on all her icons. Her colors are silver, white, and apricot. And when you think her name, Dolores, stomach acid rises to the back of your throat and it hurts. Really? You see a flash. Of silver? A wreath, an airport bag, and blonde hair, you don't know why. Another choice, perhaps? This is X resemble or worship Dolores Day? Inland Empire says, steer clear of this one. There's something terrible about this one. Okay, so maybe Pain Threshold wasn't choosing Dolores Day, but was reacting to the choice and going, oh my god, Dolores Day. Steer clear of this one. There's something terrible about this one. What? Okay. I guess what wasn't steering clear? A strange sensation of loss. When she left the earth, the dust and ice and the humans... That is unimportant to the quiz. Stop thinking about this. Yes, the quiz is impersonal. No need to rouse sensations in yourself at the mention of Dolores Day, who was the first innocence. It wasn't Dolores Day. I thought Sola. Incorrect. Okay, that's the Perkinassian. I'm saying that right. Sola was anointed during the previous century and even lived to see the current one. She was an urban planner who spoke her mind and largely left history to its own devices, encouraging people to excel on their own rather than prescribing to a deified model of history. She is often called an anti-innocence. Sola resigned after an assassination attempt by a Yugo nationalist who blamed her for not taking the side of the left during the turn of the century revolutions. Innocences don't usually resign. Care to try again? Yeah, we only got one choice left. I'm glad these are multiple choice. A, B, C, D, all the above. They were all the first one. So, in a way, it's kind of good that I failed this because we got to read a lot more about Dolores Day and Sola. Otherwise, I guess I would have just said correct and told us about the Perkinassian and then continued to the next question. Correct. Nothing much is known about him. It's not even clear that he was a he, but Franco-Negro presumed as such and called him pious. He's depicted as a young man with molten gold pouring out of his mouth. All he spoke was gold. It said he invented gold. Sorry, it said he invented God and the equality of men before God. He also introduced the gold standard as a way of measuring people's love for Aurum, some kind of audio thing. As the first innocence, he declared that there should be more of those like him. It is presumed his disciples were the beginning of the holy party, the founding party. So they're like saints, basically. Who was the strongest innocence? Encyclopedia says, easy! Everybody knows the answer to this. You, me, anybody. He's not gonna tell me, is he? I would think with Dolores Day. Sure, try again. I trust you've got my back. He's just telling us about an innocence. I hate you right now, Encyclopedia. You've got the answers, but you're not giving me the answers I need. An innocence is the highest category of historic personage in the world, a literal personification of history. Traditionally, an innocence, when anointed, assumes supreme rule over the Occident, or the known world in general, at least the parts that matter. Yes, yes, so interesting, but I thought you'd give me the answer to the question. I can do better. Okay, so commonly innocence does not enforce his or her power through military power. This is seen as unnecessary. The innocence wins because the innocents can't help but win for their deeds or inevitabilities. Did this help? No. Damn. Pain Threshold is saying Dolores again. You're not right. So the strongest... one wins because their deeds are inevitabilities. I don't know if it said that she was really that strong. Let's go back to what... Humanism, internationalism, and the welfare state created... codified democracy. She was powerful and beautiful. But was she the strongest? Sola, an urban planner. looks like Sola did. Well, Sola's not one of the choices. I have no idea. I don't know anything about Franco Negro. They reference Franco Negro somewhere up here. Correct. Franco Negro presumed as such. Presumed that Paracoinassian was a he. To say Dolores is powerful. I am choosing Dolores Day, but not because Pain Threshold says Dolores. Pain Threshold is just basically obsessed with Dolores right now. Incorrect again! While she originated many modern institutions, launched several successful expeditions, and was even critical of the Innocentic system itself, and somehow keeps popping up in your mind, thanks Pain Threshold, she is not often considered the strongest. Even though the words most associated with her rule are l'amour, la compassion, l'autodiscipline, love, compassion, self-control, which could be seen as facets of strength. Would you try? Care to try again? Would like to try again. I never even heard of this Vesper Messina, so let's try Franco Negro. Correct. Named the innocence of militarism, he codified hereditary rule, but at the same time ended serfdom and established the Intersolari Real as the global reserve currency. He also established the concept of the nation. They did a lot. And we have him to thank for Real. Franco Negro attempted to solve the rising tensions between the aristocracy and the bourgeoisie by building a unified society in which every man had a place and a mission, but at the same time may rise to nobility provided on the strength of his virtue. Question 3. Who was the false innocence? Encyclopedia says, got it under control. No problem. Solid on this one. It's widespread historical information. Are you going to be helpful this time? I could use a hint. Yes, there exists a group called the Founding Party, known as the Holy Party during the time of the Paracarnassian. This, the world's oldest international organization, spends its time in search of either the reemergence of the innocents or new members. Sigh heavily out loud. There seems to be a mix-up with the sources. It's not my fault. Pain Threshold says, at least it clearly wasn't Dolores Day. She wouldn't be false. She's beautiful. I can choose it anyway. But I want to get the test right. I mean, if I get them all wrong, I could damage my psyche. Who knows? I don't know who these people are. Well, this person's despicable, so seems likely that they would be false since they're so despicable. Stepan the Despicable? Incorrect. Stepan the Despicable, regent of Kedra, was a ruler who conquered the known world during the Kedriatic conquest instead of the despotic Erno Pasternak. Would you try again? Conquered the known world instead. Oh. Well, Erno Pasternak is a despot, so maybe the despot is a what? A false one? False innocence? How could he be a despot and an innocence? Unless Pasternak was never considered an innocence at all. But yeah, I'm gonna try that one. Correct. Breakthrough imminent on the Van Eyck thing. Question. There have been a number of counter or false innocences, some assumed to have innocentic qualities, some who just thought so themselves. Occasionally, they have the support of a faction inside the ecclesiastic organization, and accusations of foul play have arisen. The most famous and important of these was Erno Pasternak. He was into torture, despotism, hymns, canons, and world conquest. What's wrong with hymns? One of these things doesn't belong, huh? But got defeated and humiliated by Stepan the Despicable of Kedra. Final stretch. You've come so far and learned so much. This is the most important one. Question 4. Who was the greatest innocence? The most important to them all. The most precious to humankind. Dolores Day. I've got it, Encyclopedia says. Honest. Are you sure this time? I'll bite. Hit me! Of course, this is my thing. The reason I exist in this world. The correct answer is Franco Negro. You're absolutely certain of this? Zero doubts. Pain Threshold says, well, it was actually her. I thought it was Dolores Day. Encyclopedia's been messing with me, though. So, I mean, technically not incorrect things, but just not telling me anything useful. But this time, saying no doubts, it's Franco Negro. But me, well, this time, my encyclopedia in my head thinks Dolores Day, although Franco Negro did accomplish quite a lot. I mean, we wouldn't have nations if it weren't for Franco Negro. We wouldn't have Real if it wasn't for Franco Negro or our, you know, belief system. Not our belief system, our currency, system of currency. Codified hereditary rule and its serfdom. Every man has a place and a mission, but may rise to nobility provided on the strength of his virtue. I think the twist is that it's Dolores Day. Correct! The mess. So Encyclopedia was wrong. Encyclopedia was wrong, but says I've got it. Success. Huh. The mask might see Franco Negro as the father of nations, but as of this century, there's been a great shift in attitude. Dolores Day has become widely regarded as the greatest innocence, a most radical change to the whole fabric of the world. Yeah, we learned quite a lot about of Dolores Day, guys, when we were back in the church, and we were looking at the stained glass mural, or stained glass picture, whatever you call it. Learned quite a lot about her, and yeah, basically, she was frickin' amazing and all that. And as some kind of personal thing, I see lost his faith in her or something, or she resembles his ex-girlfriend, ex-wife in some way. He associates Dolores Day with her or vice versa. Something's going on with that. I want to find out. Everything from intersolary travel to the connected world to three consecutive scientific revolutions can be traced back to her. Every decade that passes, she seems less human somehow and more beautiful. Pain Threshold says, and more beautiful, and more beautiful. Congratulations on finishing the test. The results and your subsequent grade have been calculated. You get a D. Not particularly remarkable, but technically a passing grade. Not that anyone really expected better. Hey! Inland Empire says, you would have done better if you just left Dolores Day for the end. Dial the Dolores Day down a bit. Damn you, you arrogant book. You were shouting at an inanimate object like a real weirdo. No wonder you seem to have trouble with the right answers. Can I take the test again? The first innocence, the Paracarnassian, correct. Introduced to the gold standard as a way for measuring people's love. You, blah, 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 blah. Who is the strongest innocence? I want to hear about Vesper Messina, though. Incorrect. Vesper Messina is not a person, but a defunct state on the southeastern coast of the Occident. It used to take up most of the peninsula before separating into the republics of Vesper and Messina. Can I try again? Yeah, I knew that was wrong, guys, but I just wanted to hear or who that was, and it's not even a who. It's a state on the Occident southeastern coast. What is it? The strongest? The strongest innocence. The strongest one. Franco Negro. Who's Kedra? Incorrect. Kedra is a large nation, again, a nation now, in the mid-northern area of the Mundi Isola, north of the Occident, between the Imralian mountain range and the Siantic Mare Interregnum. Kedra, try again. What is it, Dolores? Oh, stop thinking it. I said it wasn't her. She was true, Pain Threshold says. Okay, it's, this, Erno Pastorak. I wonder what it says here. While Franco Nero built concrete churches and cathedrals, and while many people, especially the mess, consider him a father figure due to his militarism and nationalism, Gio Paolo blah, 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 argues differently. Another choice. Encyclopedia says, oh yes, militarism and nationalism. My bad. Pasternak? Incorrect. He was a violent bastard out to torture, maim, and kill whoever stood in his way. He was also a false innocence, disqualifying him from being the greatest and most important and most precious to humankind. Correct. A D. Screw you again, you damn condescending prick. I swear I'll rip you apart. How is it possible that you're messing this up? Are you doing it on purpose? Yes, this time I was doing it on purpose. We'll do it all right this time and see if anything awesome happens. You're getting them all right? Okay. Who was the first one? The Paracarnassian. Correct. Who is the strongest one? Franco Negro or Negro. Correct. Who is the false? Inner Pasterak. Correct. The most precious, Dolores Day. An A, all correct, impressive, oddly so. It's almost as if you've gone back and done things over. Well, I gained experience just for doing that. A little bit, it leveled me up. Inland Empire says, you really navigated some treacherous waters here. Well done. But endless tries aren't really fair, don't you think? Whatever. Alright, so... Didn't I already have a skill point? I should have 2 skill points. Because I was going to level up empathy, but decided not to. Or did I use one by... Did I use one by using this over again? That other thought cabinet. I thought I unlocked that for use for anything. Okay, so Egghead is clearly not Van Eyck in disguise. Good, because that would have been a weird twist. Van Eyck is an Aurigny's disc jockey, but those people get around. Those people get around, especially in Revachol, in the clubs on Boogie Street. Perhaps he stayed here for a short stint and discarded part of the song he was working on, just threw it away, and then it ended up in the hawthorn tree. But why? Did he think it was retrograde? It wasn't. Because he caught a glimpse of the future and did not want for it to arrive just yet. Perhaps the city whispered the top line to him and he was frightened by it. All Mortorix white checks unlocked. Reveals Arno Van Eyck gig posters in the world. Okay. So we can try the white things again. Knick-knack stand. This guy has not been in the place for a while, so I can't try. He has to be there for me to use it. I don't know if that's a bug or what. Pile of clothes. Oh, that the guy is selling? Joyce Messier Kim. What are we trying with Kim? The mirror, we can try again in my room. My old room. The wash basin. Oh, that wash basin over here, though. And Classier. And, oh yeah, something I asked her. That was recently. Fractured bullet, we can try again. Trash container. Map wall. We can try the cockatoo thing again. Lillian, the net picker, and Andre. We can try a lot of stuff over. But I think we're going to do that next episode. Let's see, if I come out here, I don't... I don't think the tune plays at night. Okay. It's late. We've been in here reading for hours. I do want to get that other book. Definitely want to get the other Man from Heimdall book, at least, and the Dick Mullen book. The board games later, especially that one that's $25. Later for that. Now, this theme I love. She could take this theme and replace it. You know, replace the horn theme that plays in the day outside the motel and play this one. Because this one sounds very uplifting, very beautiful, and it does not give me a content ID hit on my videos. Thanks for watching. See you next time, guys. And I think we're going to try some of these white checks again and then go to bed. And then we'll rejoin with Kim and then we can get some interesting stuff done. Because I want his help with quite a number of things. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.